Hello and welcome to the Biokinetic K9 live at 5 on Friday. How are you this fine day? What are we going to be talking about today is injury risk that is increased through exercise. It was a very interesting post or article that I saw this week. And although I've spoken about this before and it's not surprising, what is nice, you could say, is that it's been acknowledged and noticed out there. And that is this increased injury risk when people are actually doing conditioning exercises. Can you believe it? So, Bob, hello, how are you? Yes, this is a seriously interesting topic, especially for me. This is what we do. So, let's just take a look quickly. Let's first just do a bit of housekeeping before we get started. So, of course, my name is Angela Hearn. I'm the owner and founder of the Biokinetic K9. I'm a certified canine athlete specialist and canine myofascial release practitioner. I love my job. So I've posted this in a few groups out there. So if you're seeing it anywhere else, please pop on over to the Biokinetic K9 page and give us a thumbs up and like. And if you think your friends will benefit from it, please share this video with them. So if you're commenting or you're watching after we finish the live, post in the comments and I'm happy to answer you guys. So please pop over to my page, post your comments here, and then I'm sure to get them. So let's get cracking. First of all, why do people exercise their dog? Same reason people go to the gym, really. I find that most people exercise because, okay, well, they're doing a sport or they think their sport is exercise too, and they enjoy that training with their dog. They really enjoy it. The dogs enjoy it too. But they will do maybe some exercise and fitness particular exercises, because now we're going to be off the topic of just general training our dog for sport, but we're going to be going on to the topic of exercises for fitness and conditioning for our sport or for our dog or for whatever reason we're doing it. But people really go into fitness exercises because they want to get their dog fit, or they want to get their dog stronger in some or other area, or they want to get their dogs better in a sport, they want better performances from their dog, or they are doing it because they fear injury. So they think, oh, let me do some exercises because I know then my dog's injury risk will come down. So they go and do exercises for fear of injury. And then also they're going to be doing fitness and conditioning exercises because it's post-rehab, or they're doing rehab and they have to do extra conditioning exercises with their dog. So those are the basic reasons why people get into it. You can almost say it's a sport where people want their dogs to look better. And so a lot of it is for ego. And you see some of these dogs, they look really smart. They look quite gorgeous. But it is for ego and also to do better in a conformation ring. There's so many people out there that don't do fitness and conditioning with a conformation ring sport. And it is absolutely essential. That is where a breed is showcased. So you want your dog in that conformation ring to be in the best shape he can be. So those are the basic reasons why people exercise their dogs. So for fear of injury, for fitness, for their sport, or for post-rehab concerns. However, if you are doing exercise and it goes unchecked, what are we talking about here? Well, I'm going to quote a sentence from, it was a rehab practice, they're quite well known, but she says, I have recently seen a rise in injuries resulting from canine conditioning practice. So yeah, everybody's going out and they've got the best intention. So intention is good, but knowledge is better. So they've got the best intention, and you need to know what you're doing. It's like if I go to the gym now and I don't know anything about picking up weights and I've seen them in there, and you just go in and you try out the machinery and you try out the weights, it's the biggest hazard that you can imagine, where you will get most of your injuries, etc., is in a gym. If you don't know how to use the equipment and you don't know what you're doing, you can seriously injure yourself. And the same happens with conditioning exercises. So what do people go do? They go and look it up on social media. And there are some really good exercises and things that you can do with your dog, which are well explained, but there are also loads of good exercises, but may not be good for your dog, or some really like, wow, that's a bit risky. Can you do it with your dog? So what people are not taking into account many times, and what is causing an injury, is that they are not mindful of a few things. And there's some very important bits of information that you must take into account first. And number one is your dog's form in executing the exercise. How your dog conducts his body while performing that exercise is of vital importance. You can do lots of things and not all the muscles are engaged, and you think, oh yeah, my dog's doing really good guns, but the wrong muscles are being engaged, or there's compensations and his form is out. Any exercise that you're doing, just like in the gym, it's a repetitive motion. So we do like 5 sets of 10, etc., or 3 sets of 12, or 2 sets of 8, all depends on what you're doing. And you're doing something repetitively. And if the form is incorrect and you're engaging the wrong muscle every time, you are causing injury. Or if you're working your dog and you don't know your dog has got an injury already and you continue, you make the situation worse. Same as if you're just training your dog for sport, same thing happens. So they are not mindful of their form. The form, the technique of the movement is very, very important. Then you need to also look at how often are you doing it? What's the frequency of your exercises that you're doing? And what is the intensity of your exercises that you're doing? Are you taking the fitness of your dog into consideration? So, for example, I've got a senior dog. I can't go and train her exactly the same hours as I'm training my younger dog. She's senior. I've got to go a little bit slower with her. I've got to make sure that the impact is not as great. It's not a high impact exercise, a more low impact for her joints, etc. She's got general wear and tear. She's not showing any signs of any arthritic things, but I'm going to take these things into account of her age and her muscles. What about the experience of your dog? If you're training a younger dog that's just really excitable and he doesn't know where to put his feet and how to do things, or an older dog that's never done these things before, now you're asking the body to do new movements, especially if you're asking for the form to be correct. It takes huge amount of effort, not only from the body, but mentally too. And many people are not taking these things into consideration. A lot of people, unfortunately, look at the dog as, oh, well, it's a dog that can do things. But it's another living being with living structures, muscles, just like we do. And if I didn't go up to you and suddenly ask you to do a back somersault and force you to do it, you are going to be injured. Something similar in the way of how we do fitness and conditioning in our dogs. Fitness and conditioning is not trick training. It helps you if you are in the sport of trick training. It will help you get there. But conditioning in itself is not trick training. It is purposeful, mindful application of movement in the body for a reason and for a goal of activating certain muscles and making certain links within that body of the dog strong, and so it all works together and then promotes your sport. So when your exercises go unchecked, those are the dangerous points of, you don't know how many times are you doing it. Are you doing it like just small bits every day, which would be much better than a whole lot on the weekend, because then your fitness and conditioning becomes just another weekend warrior exercise. And your dog never promotes, never progresses. And so your risk of injury really increases. Is your fitness and conditioning, is it supporting a goal? What is your goal? Each exercise that you do must be there to take you a little bit further towards reaching a goal. So whether your goal is just to get your dog a little bit more fit, generally, it's a goal. What kind of level of fitness would you like? Is your dog doing this just to lose weight? That's a goal, so that you can track and monitor your progression with your dog. Is your dog, are you trying to work on increasing their jumping ability, or to increase their endurance, or increase their strength in an exercise, increase their speed in exercise, increase their stamina in exercise? These are all goals. Do you have a plan to support your goal, or are you simply doing random exercises? Your plan should include your goal and your progression of how to get there. And it can take a year, and you break down your year's plan down into four quarters in a year. So in these three months time slots, and you break it down to a month and a week. What is your goal? Are you just training for the sake of training, or are you looking to protect certain areas of your dog because of the sport that you do? Certain sports have got higher likelihood of injuries in certain areas of the body. So if you take your agility, most of the injury areas is around the shoulders, and then secondary into the waist, core, iliopsoas area. So what are your goals? Where are you going? It's always better to train a little bit each day, like we said, than a big session on the weekend. So your goal always, number one, is obviously to reduce injury, and then to maximize your sporting performance. So you want to maximize your strength, your speed, your agility, your balance and control of the body in a movement. So should you have to be competing where, oh, there's dew on the lawn today, and so it's a little bit slippery, if your dog suddenly slips, he's got a better chance of recovery because you know how to prepare for a slippery surface in a trial. You know how to warm up your dog. You know that you must warm up a little bit more when the conditions are a little bit treacherous. So does your exercise and does your training actually support your goal? This is quite a big question. It's not just, oh, yeah, sure. Then do you know why you are doing what you are doing? Do you actually know why you're doing an exercise? Is this, if you do an exercise, are you asking yourself, and what I'm doing, is what I'm doing here going to help me in my sport? Is it going to help my dog improve his performance in his sport? Or is it just a trick, or is it just a show? And I've seen these conditioning exercises, I've mentioned it before, where a dog is standing on four donuts. I can't even put it in the screen. Four donuts. It's higher than my camera lens. And he's standing up there with the dog on four donuts to say, wow, look at my dog's balance. Now, I don't understand how four donuts makes it balance better. Either your dog can balance or it can't. It's just got a longer way to fall before hitting the ground and injuring itself should the dog slip. So for these things, are you doing these things just as a trick to show off on social media, or are you doing it for a specific reason? Does your dog have the strength to do the movement? So when you're doing exercise, do you know that your dog has got the strength to do that movement? Does your dog have the strength to maintain his form in that movement, to hold his body well and strong in the movement? Doing it just once, and like you put your dog on a peanut, and, oh my word, my dog can stand on a peanut. Look at this. And he can sit and he can stand on the peanut. Is he doing it with control? Is the vibration and the shaking in the peanut down to a minimum? Is his legs splayed, or are they standing steady? Why are you doing what you do? Just because your dog can do a movement once on a piece of equipment doesn't mean that they can do it for a set of however many repetitions smoothly, safely, with good form and good skill. So be careful of jumping the gun. Know why you're doing something. Is whatever exercise you're doing with your dog right now, is it safe? And is it appropriate for your goal? Is it safe for your dog to do? And is it appropriate for your goal? These are the considerations you have to take before you start your exercises. And then what are you working in your dog? Is your dog balanced in his body, or is his body unbalanced? Quite interesting. I was looking at for humans, physical therapy and conditioning for humans. And they did some research where they were looking at just movements, because they were trying to find out why do people compensate, where compensation happened, and what are the reasons behind compensations. And so they analyzed just average people, people that did sports, people that were doing a bit of physio at various stages, people that did Pilates, people that didn't do Pilates, etc. And what they found is that the non-sporting people, the normal people that are living normal sedentary lives, had a more balanced body to work with than a sports individual. And they found because in sports, sports create muscle imbalances. And so when you have got these imbalances and the dogs are, or the people rather, are working according to these things, and now you want to balance out their body with a conditioning program, you have to take into consideration the imbalances that you are working with and the compensations they are doing now. And this is what happens with sport dogs. Their body is not balanced because they're doing repetitive motions for a particular sport, which causes imbalances and causes compensations. So if you just take that sport dog and put him through a general fitness program, that generic program, like I always say, I've never seen a generic dog. Each dog is an individual. They all move for their own purpose and they all got their own things. You have to look at the body in front of you. Where are the imbalances? And you have to structure your program and get those imbalances as balanced again as you can so that they are strong for your sport. So the sports create imbalances, and you have to be mindful of the exercises that you're doing as they have developed the competencies and the imbalances in their body. Angie, hi! Let me see you. What are you saying? Just before, because they can doesn't mean that you'd... Ooh, yes! Yes, yes! Just because they can doesn't mean they should. Are you doing it for your dog or for your ego? For the photo? For the, oh my word, because I can take my dog and let him do some exercise and it can be a flop, and then I can run through that video and pick out the perfect picture and post it and not say, ooh, this is what actually happened, guys. Just because they can doesn't mean that they should. 100%. Is what you're doing safe? And is it going to promote your goal? Is it going to promote your sport, your weight loss, your fitness program, etc.? But first, is it safe? Is the dog comfortable in doing it? Are you going to help that dog's body? If you're not going to be helping the dog's body, if you're taking a sport dog where there are imbalances and you're just going to run it through a program, or you're going to run your dog to make it fitter, you are going to cause an injury. I just saw it. It was the beginning of the week. A dog does canny cross. It's wonderfully fit, beautiful a Weimaraner, and it's beautifully built and everything, and it developed an ESO strain from running, just from running. So what can I say about that? Well, did they have a balanced program, or are they only running the dog? Because only running your dog causes imbalances. So something's gone wrong. Maybe he slipped, etc. Maybe they got a full program. We don't know. But even just running your dog, it's not a balanced program. You need to balance out the program so that you can have a balanced dog for the sport that you are doing. Awesome question, Angie. Yes, or not question, answer, or quote, or point. So are you looking at a balanced body or an unbalanced body? And are you addressing those things, or are you just running them through a program? Because if you're just running them through a program, you will cause an injury, even though you have the best intentions. You need to apply your mind and your knowledge. And that is why it's always important to go to somebody that knows, that can help you with your dog. You need a team. Your team is you and your dog and the people that can help you get there. Very important. So when it comes to increased risk of injury while just doing conditioning exercises, how do you know if your dog's got an injury now or not? Are you doing something incorrect, or are you doing it correct? And are you just carrying on through this injury? And the most difficult part is if you're dealing with a high drive dog, they don't show you that they're injured. That's why we're doing our live workshop. Our live workshop tomorrow is the last one. If you still want to reserve your seat, you're most welcome. Put a comment that you want to, and I will send you the link. So we're doing a live workshop. We did one on Tuesday. I had a really awesome time. We had some extra bonus content. Just because of I ask people when they sign up, I ask them why are they signing up, and some of the answers prompted the bonus content. So it runs a little bit longer than the 90 minutes. It's now 2 hours, but 2 hours of great information. So if you want to know if your dog is sporting the small, and we're not talking about a major injury, hey? We're just talking about like a cramp, like a pulled muscle, a knot, and you don't know your dog has got one, and you continue training, you can cause an injury. But we can show you how to spot these things beforehand so that you can just rub it out or have a quick massage session or a quick physio so that it can be worked out quickly and you don't sit with a big muscle tear in the end. So you're trying to avoid all of these things. So if you want to learn about how to do this and to spot those small injuries in your dog, please sign up, put in the comments that you want to sign up, and we'll put you in for tomorrow. So it's tomorrow in South Africa at 5 p.m. in the afternoon and 10 a.m. Eastern time. So I'll see you guys there. We've got loads of people that are coming tomorrow, so I'm looking really forward to this. And then just a small note, I have been really, I'm like, oh, wow, this is so nice. I've been asked to be interviewed by my friend and mentor, the person that trained me, Dr. Erica Bowling. So she's going to be interviewing me tonight at 8:30 Eastern time, and you can pop onto Northeast Canine Conditioning. Look out for the link and the, I don't know what you call it, the thing that it's coming up. And then you can see us speaking about canine conditioning and fitness, one of my all-time favorite topics, of course. So log on to Northeast Canine Conditioning, go and like their page and get the warning that the interview is coming up. So I'm really looking forward to it. So for me here in South Africa, it's going to be about 3:30 in the morning. I'm setting my alarm clock and then I'm going to hop on over to that interview because it's going to be a live one. I'm so excited. Okay, guys, so that is us for today. Please watch out for your dog. So if you are exercising your dogs, don't run that risk of injury. Please, it's not worth it. Watch out for your form. And if you want to know a little bit more about what we do, go on to my webpage. It's the biokinetick9.com. Oh, Linda, tomorrow, you are saying what time is it tomorrow? It is at South African time, 5 p.m. And in the U.S., it's 10 a.m. Eastern time. Yeah, 10 a.m. Eastern time. So, but I'll put the link in here if you want to go and just check. You can check, and there you go. So I'm really looking forward to it. Let me just put this up so that you guys know. Here is my live workshop: easily body checks to help expose injuries your sporting dog may be hiding from you. The interview tonight. It is 8:30 Eastern time. 8:30 Eastern time. So there you go. But just pop onto Northeast Canine Conditioning and then we'll be there. So if there's no questions, then if you do have questions, and I'm not here to answer them right now, then just put them in the link, the comments below. Otherwise, send me an email at fit@thebiokinetick9.com. And there you go. That is me for today. My Friday is up. Please be mindful of your exercises. That's the biggest thing. Just be mindful about what you're doing. Number one, is it safe for your dog? And number two, does it further your goals? Is your dog's form? Three, is your dog's form correct? That form is the most important. Okay, everybody. So have a very, very awesome weekend. And I'm going to see all the other guys tomorrow. Cheers. Let me put up my rest of my information and I will see you then. Cheers, everybody. Get my technical stuff ready. Bye-bye now.